honour to welcome Hilary Wainwright to the Trades Council tonight. She has an expertise on automation and workplace practices and what have you. So without any further ado, Hilary.
Pleasure to be here. I seem to be doing a bit of a tour of Midlands Trades Council. So I was last month at Coventry at Cocoa. It's rather different circumstances here, rather plush compared to Cocoa, but you know, they're equally good. I don't know what Wolverhampton will be like, but they haven't invited me yet. So anyway, actually, I think bouncing off the care workers, I think, is important, because when we talk about automation, we've got to actually also recognise the importance of the work that can't be automated. And in a sense, part of a kind of politics of automation in the workplace must start with that, must start with valuing care work, all the sort of human relationship work, you know, teaching. I know teaching is being subjected to automation through MOOCs and this kind of thing, but, you know, care work, to be done well, needs real human care, yeah, human interaction. So, you know, your strike's not just immediately important for you, but is of historic importance for challenging the way that where this society is going, because it's that valuing of the care work that's crucial to thinking about the kinds of consequences of automation that we want. You know, we want some kind of redistribution of wealth that enables care work to be really valued. But that depends on, you know, what priorities govern our society and govern our economy. And as I was, you know, thinking about coming here, you know, there are all the, you know, the news about Carillon, and then Capita, you know, just Capita collapsing. I just, you know, apart from the impact on the workers, and their pensions and so on, I just relish the fact that Capita is about to collapse, because, you know, this company was made out of privatisation, essentially. And I think that why it does link into automation is because, something I'll come on to in more depth later, is that technology isn't neutral. You know, it's not about, you know, technology, progress, we must support it, what come what may. You know, all technologies involve choices and values, and it's always technology for what goal. So in a way, automation can be a benefit to humanity, or it can be destructive. That depends on who's in control, who's running the economy. And so what's important now, I feel, is that we are at a kind of turning point, that the point about the crisis of privatisation and the unravelling of the whole process of privatisation is that it's not just a crisis of the economy. You know, there've been lots of crises of the economy, the financial collapse, periodic crises of the capitalist economy. But that's slightly different, always raising the question of, well, how will people respond? Whereas this is not just a crisis of the economy, but it's actually a crisis of the market, the whole idea of the market as being in some sense efficient. I mean, if you remember the way in which privatisation was being sold, firstly by Thatcher, but then in a way even more hyped up by Tony Blair, as, you know, it's only the market that can be efficient, you know, the public sector is inefficient, that basic slogan of public bad, private good, you know, it was absolutely built into the last 30 years. And that is now, you know, just coming apart. You know, it's not just that private companies are being shown to be inefficient. I mean, there's been research documenting the failure of PFIs and the inefficiency of private companies. But now the companies themselves are collapsing and are kind of seeking government support, seeking, if you like, public. I mean, they've always had public support because they've always been getting money from the public sector. But I think this is a kind of a key turning point in which we can begin to really think about alternatives. And so, in a way, what I want to talk about tonight is about that issue of how we think about and develop alternatives to the market, to the existing kind of economy. Because, you know, in a way, we've had 40 years of being on the defensive, and you just get into the habit of it. You know, you don't have the confidence, you don't have the vision to be thinking about alternatives, because we've just been, you know, battered and battered and battered, both materially but also morally. So, you know, the whole project of New Labour was basically degrading the public sector, degrading public service workers, and that was obviously linked into their attempt to marginalise the left. So what are our resources? What are our, you know, what's the thinking through which we can develop alternatives? And I mean, I know I'm a bit old, so this is maybe obvious, but I think what we should be doing is going back to, in a way, the alternatives that we were developing in the 70s and 80s, before we were sort of rudely interrupted, if you like, by Mrs. Thatcher and by New Labour, because there was a lot going on then that we can't go back to. So it's not a matter, I'm not saying, you know, let's just go back to the kinds of things that we were doing with Tony Benn and in the 70s, but more, are there examples there that we can draw the basic principles from and then think about how those principles could be applied to the very different circumstances of today? I did write a note, so I must look at the back of them. And the two experiences that I wanted to focus on, but without going into too much depth, but more going on to the lessons that they give us. One is, you probably all heard about the Lucas Aerospace workers, particularly, you know, coming from Birmingham, where Lucas Industries, anyway, and Lucas Aerospace has got some sort of base. Now that is a kind of well-told story, and I'll just give a quick summary of it for people here who aren't familiar with it. I mean, just maybe out of interest, who knows the story of the Lucas Aerospace workers' alternative plan? Okay, so quite a few don't. So I'll just tell you very briefly, not in order to be nostalgic, but in order to then pull out what can be learnt. And then there was another case I wanted to draw on of a successful fight against privatisation in Tyneside and the lessons that can be drawn from that. And then end up sort of discussing the main principles and what that means for organisation now. What are the kind of problems of organising around alternatives in today's circumstances, which are obviously the trade union movement's very weak, very, very much weaker. Local authorities are battered and emasculated by the combination of the Tories and New Labour. But on the other hand, we have this amazing political opportunity of a possible Labour government, you know, which, I mean, I think isn't about waiting for them and hoping they get in and doing a bit of extra canvassing. It is about, you know, preparing for real power. I mean, hopefully they're going to win office, but we all know that's not power. And that whether or not they have power or not depends a lot on what kind of mobilisation of alternatives there is in the country. But anyway, I'll come back to that. So very quickly, the Lucas Aerospace story was basically workers facing a whole rationalisation that was taking place in the 70s of companies, particularly British companies, that were facing a lot of competition from particularly German companies and companies in the south, and were rationalising their own capacities, closing factories, moving workers or getting rid of workers, basically sort of slimming down, that sort of lean and mean approach. And the workers at Lucas Aerospace, who were consisted of some of the most highly skilled, highly trained designers and technicians and engineers certainly in Britain, possibly in the world, they said, well, hang on a minute, you know, we're not redundant. Our skills are not redundant. They're not useless. They can be used to address all the problems of environmental chaos, of poverty, of bad transport, you know, that exist across the world. And, you know, they've got some experience of alternative design ideas. So they had real belief in their own members' capacities. This was a shop stewards combine committee, bringing together shop stewards from all the different factories across the country, all the factories in Lucas Aerospace. So they had a considerable kind of strength then. I mean, that was days of not full employment, but, you know, at least quite high employment and kind of competitive threats, which meant that a strike had a real impact. And so those workers were very well organised, very strong. And so they went back to their members saying, well, what can we be producing? You know, management says we're redundant. We don't think so. What do you think? So a real involvement of the members in the idea, that was crucial. And they came up with a whole series of of alternative products. Someone was a one of the most famous was a road rail vehicle that could move from the road to the rail, to the railways, and therefore help to facilitate a more integrated transport system. Another was a sort of energy conservation mechanism which worked a bit like a sort of fridge in reverse, you know, but I don't know, I can't explain these things very well because I'm not technically very proficient. Some sort of medical equipment, you know, a lot of different ideas that were spelt out in practice with actual prototypes, because the argument, another key argument, was that workers have got huge amounts of knowledge. I mean, the whole production of the wealth of this country depends on the knowledge of frontline workers, and workers in engineering, in manufacturing generally, as well as in the public sector. But that knowledge is often practical. It's best expressed through what people do. You know, so this was not an alternative plan that could necessarily be put in terms of a resolution to Labour Party conference. It was just produced actual prototypes. Anyway, it became a very symbolic idea, and many other workers copied it in Chrysler, in British Leyland, in many other companies. This idea of workers producing their own alternative, which they didn't put to management like a sort of suggestion box, you know, for management to sort of pick up. They organised around it as a bargaining focal point, and that was a direct challenge to managerial prerogative. And not surprisingly, management in the end said no, and the government, who had by this time sacked Tony Benn, who'd encouraged this idea, he'd brought all the workers into his office, much to the sort of scandal, you know, the civil servants were like saying, workers, you know, okay, we work with officials, trade union officials and the Confed and so on, but, you know, a shop stewards, you know, this is madness. So this is one of the things that led to Tony Blair being completely demonised. Anyway, so he was, Tony Benn, yeah, sorry, he was sacked, so the government was pretty hostile. So the project was defeated, but it was one of these defeats which didn't mean a failure. You know, it wasn't, the idea wasn't invalid, and in fact many of the products had been taken up in other countries. Mm-hmm. And the whole idea of workers producing alternatives based on their knowledge, I mean, they're the people that actually do the production, so they've got this capacity, you know, is one that sort of has lived on. And you know, sometimes now it comes up around climate change. So I remember having a discussion with younger members of Red Pepper, which is a magazine that I co-edit, and they were talking about, you know, alternatives to high carbon forms of production. And they were saying things like, well, we heard there was some group of workers in the 70s, I think it was called Lucas, you know, they were sort of saying, I said, oh, do you mean Lucas? I said, yes, that's it. So suddenly it became relevant again, and a new generation of people were interested. So I thought, well, let's just look at what the key principles were there that we can now build on and think how we could build on. So the first one was this idea I referred to earlier, that technology is not neutral. So, you know, Mike Cooley, who was one of the designers involved in this, he's written a very good book called Architect or Be, highlighting the creativity of human beings as distinct from bees. That human beings conceive of a project before they do it. You know, they have a mental plan, the imagination, which maybe a bee doesn't have. I don't want to denigrate bees, but you know, I don't think they do. Anyway, so he's explained and written in great detail about this, and you can see it in an earlier kind of technological revolution, if you like, the one around what people call Fordism, mass production. And that was based on a specific set of values. So the guy that designed the technology behind Fordism, a guy called Taylor, Frederick Winslow Taylor, anyway, his methodology was that all discrimination must be eliminated from the worker on the production line. He's not got to have any decision-making power, no power to rebel, no power to innovate, no power to take decisions. And this was what guided the technology of mass production, the conveyor belt. So that was a choice, you know, a conscious choice. We want to eliminate workers' capacities. We want them to be implementing basically a kind of design that, you know, management controls. So all the knowledge is with management, and the worker simply does as he's told. And that was the basis of, you know, Ford's whole system, and the system which then, you know, ran throughout the car industry. You know, it was based on, you know, higher wages, but for completely undignified, you know, mindless labour. And the Lucas workers are saying, you know, we want to, you know, there's nothing wrong per se with automation. Automation can be useful, but it needs to be under the control of the workers so it can be developed in a way that doesn't actually eliminate the skill of the skilled worker, but actually enables that worker to have, you know, greater capacity, greater productivity through, in a way, you know, using those forms of technology in the machine, in the way the machine tools are programmed. You know, the programming still has to be done by the human being, and if it's done by the worker, not done through his knowledge or her knowledge being taken by the manager, then he or she remains in some ways in control. So there are a lot of ways in which any of you that are technologically equipped can see, you know, that actually the way that a technology is being implemented depends on our goals and our values. I mean, you know, I was talking to David on the way about trains. You know, I don't know if you have the experience of where you are a bit late getting your stuff together to leave the train, and it's maybe going from Birmingham to Glasgow, and you just want to go to Wolverhampton, and you know, you haven't got your stuff ready, and you get to the door and it's already closed and you can't get out, and you're zooming off to, you know, Preston or somewhere. You know, well, that's to do with the design of the technology of the train. You know, it's designed for maximum speed. You know, it's not designed with the human care. You know, we need a few care workers in on the design of, you know, of train doors and train, you know, exit systems, so that, you know, they take account of people being a bit slow, people, you know, not wanting to rush leaving the train. All these things could be built into the design. So you just take any innovation and you ask, what's it for? Is it for speed, for profit, for lowering costs, or is it to benefit the users and the people in the end going to experience and use that product? So that's that, you know, the key sort of principle that I'll then come back to how we can implement that, fight for that now. Because obviously it's partly through trade union strength, but that can't be enough now when we've got such a weak, you know, well, not hopeless, but relatively weak trade union position. We need a stronger set of alliances to be successful. And then the other key point I learned from Lucas Aerospace is this point about knowledge. You know, in a way, the whole structure of the Labour Party is based on the idea that basically there's a division between politics and industry, that the politicians control the policy making, and the workers, you know, provide the votes, provide the funds, and concerned with industrial relations. So Beatrice Webb, who was one of the architects of Labour policy and the Labour, 45 policy and the Labour constitution, she said in her diary, she said, we, and that's her and Sidney Webb, who was equally powerful, don't believe that the average sensual man, you know, the ordinary person, man or woman, has got the capacity to, he or she can describe the problem, but they cannot actually prescribe the solution, so we must bring on the expert. So the whole methodology of the Labour Party, without, you know, I'm a member and so on, and obviously it's changing, but the old methodology, even in 45, was based on the expert knowing, you know, Beveridge and Keynes and all these people, knowing what was in the interest of the people. And I think one reason why Jeremy Corbyn is so important and such a force for change is because he's turning all that upside down. He says very clearly that the wisdom lies on the streets. And he was involved, not in Lucas Aerospace, but he worked for the engineering union at that time, British Leyland and so on. And that recognition that actually, you know, the base of the Labour Party, the members of trade unions, members of the Labour Party, have the knowledge, you know, instead of when Labour gets into government, they go to management, they should be going to their own members, their own skilled, knowledgeable members. And in a way, that's the opportunity. And that's one that Jeremy Corbyn and John McDonnell are very explicitly, you know, saying. John McDonnell at a meeting of the World Transformed, the last Labour Party conference, said, you know, we'll get into government, you know, we'll pursue the nationalisation of the industries, railway, etc., energy, telecoms and so on. But, you know, we depend on you, the members, the unions, to actually provide us with the power and the knowledge that will make that a reality and make it different from the old style nationalisation. So those are the two kind of lessons which seem relevant now. And obviously part of that points to the importance of the unions seeing themselves not just as defensive organisations, but organisations that in a way bring together the knowledge of the workforce. You know, that, in a sense, that's what was happening in Lucas Aerospace. And it did happen also, I won't go into detail because time's running out, but in this fight against privatisation, where the workers in Newcastle, it was an IT system, and they said, again, they said, you know, privatisation isn't going to help. It's us that know, you know, we know how the system can be improved. We've been operating it. It's our knowledge that can make things different. We're not going to give our knowledge to BT. We're just going to take the savings and turn them into profits. If it remains in-house, our knowledge can be then the basis for savings that improves the conditions of home care workers or youth workers or frontline workers. So that's basically the sort of possibility. And so, but that involved the unions there, that was Unison, actually not being just the means of bargaining over wages and conditions, but actually the way of gathering the knowledge of its members about how that system worked. And so there's a lot of lessons there about how the unions need to change to be, in a way, the pioneers of alternatives in the here and now. I mean, in the women's movement, that was my sort of formative political experience, we talked about prefigurative change, that is, trying to create in the present a sense of what the future could be like. And I think that's what the unions need to be doing now in defending their members, also talking about what it could be like. And then I think the other thing is looking at other initiatives that are taking place often outside the unions, because the context, particularly for young workers, is so dire that and often they're not in unions because the unions have been so weakened. And so all sorts of initiatives, like today, David and I went to see a fab lab in Coventry. And that's basically, I mean, it's being backed by the university, but we'll come on to universities, but, you know, not with great energy, because the university is mainly concerned about making profits itself out of accommodation, out of housing. So it's no longer about genuinely the production of knowledge for the use of the community or the use of society. But it's because of its image, I guess, it's taken this initiative, which is part of an international movement of creating a facility where there's all kinds of machinery. There's 3D printers, there's laser systems, all kinds of machinery that, you know, people can come in off the streets, maybe retired skilled workers or younger workers, and if they've got an idea, there'll be people there, volunteers, sometimes from the university, sometimes themselves retired skilled workers, helping to develop that idea so that it could maybe go into production. I mean, that would then require proper funding of an investment, or, I mean, McDonald's talked about a national investment board, and in a way that's the kind of thing it could be funding, you know, cooperatives, new public enterprises that are based on innovations that have come from the community, that have been facilitated by the university. So there are other initiatives like this that are coming partly from, in a way, one of the benefits of the of automation is a kind of newly educated generation who are really on top of the new technology and who are thinking about how to develop it. I mean, there was a young kid there, about 10 years old. She was developing programming for games. Okay, games, you know, can be just seen as kind of commercial crap, but they needn't be. They could be more for social purposes or for facilitating collaboration and cooperation, and they could be the basis of co-ops or whatever. You know, so there are all these different things that could be done. So I think that we've got to build alliances. We've got to both strengthen our unions to develop alternatives, and then also build alliances. And then finally, think about the different actors in this. So I think universities could be one of these, but it would require real struggle in the universities, because the thing is, so many of our institutions have just been completely marketized. So we've almost got to, with this unraveling of privatization and marketization, we've got to grasp the opportunity, not just, you know, sort of relish it, but also grasp it to say, okay, so what's our alternative in the case of all these institutions? What could a university be like if it wasn't just concerned about making profits through accommodation? How could it organise knowledge so that it was actually of social benefit? So I think we could apply that to, you know, to councils and so on. But all the time, we should be preparing for a change of government, but trying to win victories now, so we're both more powerful and more confident, but always based on a vision that will be hopefully implemented by a new government.